the GED math exam, you need to know what to study. All of math is not on this test. In this video, I'm gonna lay out exactly what you need to know to score a 145 and pass the GED math exam. This is the second video out of four where I'm going over the four categories of math skills that you need to know to pass the GED math exam. Those are operations with rational equations, geometry and measurement, expressions and equations, and graphs and functions. I'll link the first video about operations with rational numbers up above and down below. In that video, to introduce the series, I go even more in depth about how to create a study plan for the GED math exam, so make sure that you catch up on that if you missed it. Today I'm going to go over a high-level look at all the skills that you need to know in that second category, geometry and measurement. Again, all of math is not on the test, so having a better idea of what you need to study will help you to identify the best resources for you. There are 8 skills in particular that you're going to need to focus on. As you may have guessed, since this category is about geometry, the first couple skills are all about geometric shapes. The first skill to focus on is being able to find the area and perimeter of different two-dimensional shapes. That includes rectangles, triangles, circles, other polygons, and composite figures, or shapes made up of two or more shapes. A popular one is this kind of thing, like a basketball court or a track. It's made up of half of a circle and a rectangle. Luckily, there are formulas for finding the area and the perimeter for these shapes, and you don't need to memorize any of them. While you take the GED math test, you'll have access to a formula sheet that looks like this. You can use it to find the formula for any shape that you need on the test. So the big thing for this skill is being able to think about what the shapes are and for you to be able to identify what shape you're being asked about. The GED questions are usually about everyday objects, so they're not gonna say rectangle necessarily, they might say a football field, and you'll need to know that that's what they're talking about. You also need to be able to figure out if a question is asking about the perimeter or about the area, because it doesn't always say those words. Questions about the inside of a shape, like how much material you would need to cover a floor, those are about the area. A trick here is that answers to these questions always have units like square feet or square inches or square centimeters. That's because the formulas for area involve multiplication. So if you take feet times feet, what you end up with is square feet or feet squared. Questions about the outside of a shape are about the perimeter. So for example, they might be about how much fencing you would need to fence your yard, or how far it would be to walk around the edge of a parking lot. Those answers will just be in regular feet, centimeters, or inches, because when you're finding the perimeter, you're just adding the dimensions, and that does not change the unit. Another important thing for you to focus on is what the formulas mean and how to use them. Because even though the formulas are provided to you, they're not in plain English, and there's very little explanation of how to use them. So make sure that when you look at 1/2 BH, you know what those letters stand for and how you can use them to find the area of a triangle. Skill number 2 is skill number 1 in reverse. You need to be able to find a missing dimension given the area or perimeter of a shape and one of the other dimensions. So for example, if you're given one side of a rectangle and the area of a rectangle, you should be able to find the other side, the length or the width that you're missing. Again, you can use the formulas provided if you know how. So you want to focus your attention on knowing what those formulas mean and how to use them. It's worth noting that some of these problems could require a little bit of algebra to solve. But if you're not feeling comfortable with those skills, you can always use substitution to guess and check with the multiple choice questions. We'll talk a little bit more about that in the next video about expressions and equations. Skill number 3 is just like skill number 1, except now we're going to be working with three-dimensional shapes instead of two-dimensional shapes. In this one, you need to be able to find the surface area and volume of three-dimensional shapes like rectangular prisms, like cylinders, like spheres, pyramids, and cones. If you don't know what those words mean, you need to get familiar with them along with the formulas, because the problems on this test usually talk about everyday objects like boxes or like soup cans or like balls instead of rectangular prisms, cylinders, or spheres. It's up to you to figure out what shape that is describing so that you can know what formula to use. These formulas in particular are a little tricky because a lot of them have special variables like capital B and P. Those variables reference other formulas from the 2D section, so be very, very careful with those. You also need to know if they're asking about volume or surface area. Volume problems are the ones that are talking about the inside of a shape, so how much you could fit in a box or in a can. And surface area is talking about the area of the surface of the shape, so how much material it would take to cover a box or a ball. Skill number 4 is just like skill number 2, You're noticing a pattern? If you're given a surface area or a volume, can you use the formula to find a missing dimension? Again, be really mindful of the special variables in these formulas. Sometimes the dimension that they're asking you for is the side of a shape, which is not even in the formula as written on the sheet. And of course, just like in skill 2, you can use algebra to solve these ones, or you can substitute from the multiple choice options. For skill number 5, you're gonna use the Pythagorean theorem to find a missing side length of a right triangle. This could be a missing leg of the triangle, those are the sides that make the L, or a missing hypotenuse, that's the diagonal side that connects the L. This formula is also on the formula sheet, so you don't need to memorize it. But in order to use it successfully, you need to be comfortable with squares and square roots, which we talked about a little in the previous video about operations with rational numbers. For skill 6, we're moving away from the strictly shape-based geometry. You need to be able to represent and interpret data on different types of graphs. That includes circle and bar graphs, tables, scatter plots, dot plots, histograms, and box plots. This one's really helpful for the science and social studies exams as well, because there's also data interpretation on those tests. Number 7, you need to be able to find the mean, median, and mode of a data set. These are really simple. The median is just the middle number if you arrange the numbers from least to greatest. The mode is just the number that appears most in the data set, so if there's 3 fives in the data set, that's probably the mode. And the mean is all of the numbers in the set added up and divided by the number of numbers. Sometimes this is called the average. The definitions for the mean and the median are explained on the formula sheet, so that's easy. And then the last skill in this set, number 8, is being able to use what are called combinations and permutations. These are those kinds of problems that ask you how many different kinds of sandwiches you can make if you have a certain number of bread options, cheese options, meat options, and veggie options. I would generally focus on some other skills that appear in different contexts on the test before I focus on this. Alright, so those are the 8 skills under the geometry and measurement section that you will need to know to pass the GED math test with a score of 145. There are some other skills on this test that you could master to get a higher score, but these are the skills that you need to pass. A lot of these skills require some basic algebra skills to execute, so make sure you come back next week to watch the expressions and equations section. I've mentioned before that although there is no specific GED math practice on Khan Academy, it is a great place to get practice in for these types of skills. I'll also put a link below to the Kaplan GED prep manual, but you can also use any GED book that your library has available to borrow. It's really helpful to start practicing with the calculator that you're allowed to use while you take the test, so I'll put a link to that below, and I'll also put a link to the GED formula sheet. I post new videos every Monday about how to study more effectively so that you can achieve your goals. In the coming weeks, I'm going to discuss the 2 remaining section of math skills that you need to pass the GED math test. So please subscribe if you'd like to learn more. You can also go back and watch that first video in the series about operations with rational numbers. If this video is helpful to you, please press the like button so that YouTube knows to share it with other studiers. Thanks as always for watching, and until next time, happy studying.